Good evening and welcome to Valley Viewpoint. You may have had some experiences with theft in your lifetime, and we don't want to repeat those. My guests today are going to be talking about how we can prevent those kinds of things in our lives. So welcome to the program. We have a story to tell. I have a story to tell. Years ago, I was out with my church youth group coming back on Sunday, stopped to get some gasoline and noticed that my phone was ringing. So I picked it up. It was my wife. And she says, the car's gone. And I thought, well, what do you mean the car is gone? It's gone. And she was not hysterical, but very, very concerned. And she was hoping that I could get home soon. What had happened was she'd been out to a baby shower, came home, was just going to pick something up and go someplace else. So she left the keys in the ignition in our driveway. Nice, safe, suburban, college place driveway. She gets in, she sees some dishes on the counter. Oh, I'm going to load the dishwasher. Then thinks, I can put the clothes in the dryer and get that started so it'll be dry when I get home. And by the time she got outside again, there was no car. Now I know that was just common sense and an oversight on her part. What can we be doing so that those kinds of experiences aren't repeated, or even worse, people breaking into our homes and getting our valuables and those kinds of things? So Officer Bennett, let's start with you. What are the things that we need to know to prevent these kinds of occurrences?
Well, obviously, the most important thing is to keep your valuables locked up. You know, don't leave your keys in your car. don't leave any valuables, especially out in plain view, in your vehicle. And try to park it. You know, try not to park it on the street. Your car generally is safer if it's parked in the driveway, if you don't have access to a garage.
But not absolutely, as we learned
exactly,
the hard
right.
way.
Yes.
Yeah. And Vicki, what is your role in all of this?
I'm an educator doing personal safety, and I meet a lot of victims just like your wife, where there's nothing worse than going out there and not seeing your car, or going up to your door and finding that somebody had your doors open when you knew it was shut or locked before you left. That feeling of, you know, once it's happened, you can't get it back. And so my job is to try to prevent it so that you aren't the victim.
Well, you know, before this incident, we were very casual. We felt very safe, and we don't feel threatened all the time, but we used to leave our front door open all the time. We never bothered to lock it. And
I hear that a lot.
Yeah.
I hear that a whole lot. I go to Block Watch meetings, and I'll even have people say, it's my right not to have to lock that door. But I want you to keep your whole family safe. You might feel safe when you're home, and everybody's, of course, safe when you're home, the man of the house. But what about when you're not home and they're not used to locking that door and your kids are home alone? We've had kids alone and had somebody break in.
Really?
Where somebody's daughter was homesick from school, and they had previously had a burglary and their car was stolen, and their garage door opener, I think, had been taken, something like that. So the little girl's homesick, and anyway, somebody tries to break into the house. So she's on the phone to mom, not the police, saying, you know, she's hiding, and I think somebody made some noise and they ran out, but it's scary, and it could have been worse.
So being home alone with burglars is not fun unless you're in the movie Home Alone,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But a simple thing, keeping your doors locked is an easy way to try to prevent it and get your family into the mode to lock that door just to keep the bad guy out, the just-in-case scenario.
Now, you just introduced a term that I think our audience would like to know more about. You use the term Block Watch. What is Block Watch?
Block Watch, Neighborhood Watch, you know, it's all the same thing. It's neighbors looking out for neighbors, and neighbors being in partnership with law enforcement so that they kind of all agree that if something is suspicious, they're going to report it. and they're going to let everybody else on the block know if they've had a burglary or something suspicious, so that everybody can be on the lookout and be safer.
Well, what's suspicious?
Okay.
How do I know, you know, this is something I should be concerned with?
Well, we kind of know our neighborhoods. I mean, we may not know the name of the neighbor across the street, but we kind of know what his car is, what the time and day that the cars come and go. And if we happen to see something that just doesn't feel right, it's maybe a car sitting there with a couple guys across the street that seem to be looking and haven't seen them before, you know, the neighbor across the street isn't home at the time, you know, maybe you want to get on the phone and call law enforcement, the non-emergency number, the 527-1960, and let them know
here
that
in the Walla Walla,
Walla, Walla area, College right? Place, mm-hmm. Walla Walla County, you can use that number. And it's dispatch is dispatch, whether it's 911, but this, if anyway, we can get into that
and for
at
our
a later
viewers,
time.
For our viewers in Wenatchee and Yakima and Tri-Cities, they should be looking to their own local law enforcement
correct.
Agencies to know what those numbers are ahead of time.
Right, and you should have those numbers on your refrigerator or in your phone so that you know what they are. The people are more likely to call the non-emergency number if they know it than the emergency number, just because they're afraid to call it dispatch that in case they're wrong, or maybe they're busy. They don't want to, you know, intrude, or, you know, what if they're wrong calling in that suspicious person? Maybe it's just the kids waiting to go into the house or something, you know, that live there. But if it is suspicious, if the hairs on the back of your neck go up, call it in. You don't know. We don't want you to go up there as a citizen and knock on the window and, you know, hey, we want an officer to do that. And if there's nothing going on, then at least they know somebody's looking.
What happens a lot of times too in situations like that is they'll think about it for a day and then they'll call the police. Mm. So even if it seems something really minor, we strongly urge the viewers to call that number right away, not think about it for 15 minutes or a day or whatever. Call us. If it's nothing, it's okay. Mm-hmm. And we're out there 24/7.
So the police are not annoyed if they get all these phone calls about people that think something suspicious is happening in their neighborhood? I mean, can you cover all these or?
We do our best. Mm-hmm. What does get annoying is if it's the same person calling day after day after day and it's never anything. Mm-hmm. That can be a little annoying to a guy working patrol.
But you probably have those people figured out after a while.
Yes.
It's okay.
It doesn't take long.
The average citizen sees something, that car is unusual, or haven't seen that person here before, call it in. And then what do the police do when you receive the call?
Well, the call will be dispatched to the first available officer, and a lot of times now with our new records management system, it'll be the closest officer to the scene, and they'll just go and investigate, try to identify the person, and just find out why they were there.
Now, some people just don't want to get involved, so if I call something in, will I have to talk with a police officer?
You can request to remain anonymous, because mm-hmm. We do have a lot of neighbors that are leery about, you know, the police go to a call and they come to their house. So when they call in, if they want to find out what's going on, just request the dispatcher to have the officer call them after they've cleared the call. And unless, depending upon the call load, the officer will be able to do that.
So you're able to protect the privacy of the people that call in?
Yes.
Now, you brought some toys with you today. I'm curious as to what these things are all about.
Okay, let me start first.
Okay.
Okay, one of the, you know, I'm really big on lighting. You don't have to make the world super bright, but having enough light so that you can see, if you're gonna, when I come home at night, I like to have a light on so that I can see that the area is clear, there's nobody suspicious that's gonna jump out at me, the way is clear, I can get my key out and open the door and go in. It gives me a choice to go enter the, you know, if it's super dark out, anybody could be lurking around there, and I feel safer with the light on. Also, lights that are tamper-proof makes a difference, too, that it has a cover over the light so somebody can't just walk up and unscrew the light bulb. Well, it makes you a little bit safer.
Now, I saw this movie, and I guess we shouldn't believe everything we see on television, but I saw this movie, and a woman comes home, has the remote control. The door goes up in the garage. She pulls in, and somebody is lurking in the shadows. And as soon as she does, he dives in under the car until she lowers the garage door. Now he's in. She goes inside, not realizing that he's in there. And then once he's sat there for a while, then he goes into the house. That's scary to me. Well, I mean, the people can do this kind of thing.
And sometimes if somebody's going to get into your house and they're determined, they're going to get into your house. But one thing, I like people to be aware of their surroundings so that when I tell women and men, when you leave work, make sure you look around as you leave the building to find out, you know, is there anything different, anything out of the ordinary? Is anybody watching? Get in your car. Again, take a look around. Look at your surroundings. Get in your car. And as you're driving around, it's so easy to get caught up with, oh, what am I going to make for dinner? What's going to go on? I got to help somebody with homework and on and on and on. And you're not even there yet. You're missing out on what could be on around you. So, and when you get home, pay attention. What are you seeing? Don't just go into automatic gear, get in the driveway, garage, and in. Pay attention. You might see the guy that's ready to slip under the garage and in.
Well, ever since I saw the movie, I am looking every time. And when I put the garage door down, I do go around the back of the car to see if anything's there. Nothing's ever happened that. But it did force me to think about it and to become aware that people do these crazy kinds of things. Okay, well, what else do we have here?
Well, we do have, we really stress the importance of having deadbolt locks. You know, not your $5 lock, but a good quality deadbolt with a fairly long throw on it. And keeping in mind that you can have the most expensive lock, but if this part is going into a weak door frame, it's pretty much useless. So make sure you have a good reinforced door frame as well.
So if your door frame is weak, someone can just kick it in even if you have the best lock in the world.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, so be very careful about that.
Yeah.
We are going to take a short break. When we come back, I think you've got some information about how to properly install the deadbolt lock. And we'll talk about that and about some of the other things that we can do to make it less likely that we will become a victim. Now, I guess there's no absolute guarantee that we can keep these kinds of things from happening, but we can do things to minimize our exposure or minimize the opportunities that the burglars will have. So we're going to come back and teach you how to install a deadbolt lock and talk about some other things that we can be doing to make sure that you're not the next victim. We'll be right back. Good evening and welcome back to Valley Viewpoint. If you are just joining us, my guest tonight are talking about how we can be safer in our own homes, in our own neighborhoods. Officer Tim Bennett and Vicki Ruley, who's with the Crime Prevention of the Walla Walla Police Department. So again, welcome back. Thank you for the information that you've already shared. When we went to break, we had mentioned the use of proper locks, especially deadbolt locks. So do I have to spend, you know, $200-$300 to get someone to come install these properly? Is it a really difficult thing to do, or is it something that most homeowners could do?
I would say most homeowners can install their own deadbolt, but you want to get a good quality one. And quite frankly, that relates directly to the cost of the lock. You know, there's a lot of different varieties out there. Certainly don't recommend ones on the lower end of the cost spectrum, but more than just having the good lock is a proper installation. And so we do have a diagram here that kind of shows a lot of what we're talking about. And that involves using, you know, 3-inch screws when you're screwing the striker plate into your door frame.
Not the little ones that you use for the normal plate.
Exactly, right. So having a good long screw, the wood that it's being screwed into needs to be in good condition and not rotted. Or, mm-hmm. And a lot of times with exterior doors, that is where you're going to see some rot, you know, in an older home. So it's very important to have that. You know, if the homeowner can't inspect it, you know, have somebody that can take a look at it before you go through a lot of time and effort in doing the installation. And we strongly recommend a deadbolt lock that has at least a 1-inch throw, or the piece that goes into the door frame of at least 1 inch. That it makes the lock much stronger and less likely to fail.
Great. What are some other things that we can be doing to minimize the opportunity for the burglar to get to us?
Well, you were talking about the garage, the dark garage, somebody mm-hmm. sliding under the door. Well, you can mitigate that probably by making sure there's some lighting around your garage, and also your shrubs. You know, shrubs are really, some of them are beautiful as they grow and they get bigger and bigger, but you want to make sure that the shrubs are with SEPTED, Crime Prevention Through Environmental Design, we recommend that shrubs are no higher than 3 feet, and trees cut up at least 7 feet high, so that you have a clear view of out, and also when you're on the sidewalk looking in, a clear view to your property, so that when you're driving in, you've got the lighting and the shrubs, so there's no hiding place. And just a little bit goes a long way. And
I don't know what horror movie makers are going to do if they start following your instructions. There'll be no place to
exactly.
come out of the shadows.
Yeah.
So, all right. So all that's very good. How about this time of year? I've done it. I think probably lots of our viewers have done it. You know, the car's outside. It's cold. It's frosted over, or it's covered with snow. And you don't want to sit out there in the cold getting the car warmed up. I mean, do you ever go out there and turn the key on and run back inside to get warm?
Never.
Never. Good. That's because you're a crime prevention person.
It just takes a short, you know, if you're going to do that, start your car up, then make sure you're standing there so somebody can tell you, you know, oh, there's somebody still there. You go inside the house, it just takes a second for somebody to zip into that car seat, throw it in gear, and they're out of there. So it's a valuable piece of property out there, the car. So you want to protect your property. And a simple thing of, you know, being out there and keeping an eye on your car and letting somebody else know you're keeping an eye on, or have another key so you can lock your car. That still doesn't totally protect it, because it doesn't take long to break a window and, again, drive out. Somebody wants your car that bad.
Now, earlier in the program, we talked about the block watch or neighborhood watch or whatever you want to call it. If we have a viewer out there that wants to get involved in something like that, how do you get started?
One of the easiest things right now is nextdoor.com, and it's literally nextdoor.com. Go on the website and College Places in nextdoor.com, and put in your address and join it, and you can be up to date on things going around in your neighborhood. It's like a online block watch. Or, you know, go door to door and ask your neighbors. A lot of neighbors do neighborhood parties, get-togethers, you know, barbecue, potluck, mm-hmm. When the weather starts getting better. Mm-hmm. You know, why not, you know, invite your local law enforcement officer to come to your meeting, get a few tidbits from him, meet him. I mean, how many people have met? You have a new chief that's becoming on board. You know, it'd be a great time to meet the new chief by inviting him to the block party.
So how do your officers maintain their trim fitness with going to all these barbecues? I mean, that sounds like a pretty good job.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What do you tell the people at these block parties or these barbecues, or what kind of things
basically,
do you share with them?
A lot of the same things that we've been talking about here today is, you know, being aware, making your property, your home, as safe as possible by using some of the ideas that we've presented here. And, you know, just getting to know the people. You know, there's a lot of people that maybe have never talked to a police officer before in their lives, and they're kind of reluctant or, for whatever reason, timid. Well, I mean, we're people just like they are. We have families, we have homes, we have bills. You know, we're just regular people that just have a slightly different career path than most other people.
Now, we mentioned this young lady that was sick at home. Someone broke into the home. She's calling her mother. What should we tell our kids? What should we do in the event that somebody actually does break into our home while we're there?
The first call is to 911, regardless of the age of the person who's home alone. Because mom or dad can't do anything if they're away, but the police can be there in a extremely short time, especially in a situation like that.
So you call 911, and then you go and confront the burglar?
No. Good point. No, if they don't know your home, you know, yes, some people will make noise and that'll scare them off, but there are other burglars that, for whatever reason, if they think somebody's there, they may try to do, you know, further harm. And so having that cell phone or having the 911 operator on the line with you, and when somebody's home alone and their home's being broken into, the dispatcher isn't going to end the phone call. They're going to want to keep that victim on the phone until officers arrive.
Now, a number of our viewers are probably gun owners, and there seems to be a lot of confusion these days about what a person can legally do in the event of a home invasion. What would you tell our gun owners is the appropriate response?
Well, if they want to confront the person, they can't use, just like police officers, they can't use any more force than necessary to take care of the problem. So that means if they choose to come out of the room and display the gun and that person runs off, they should probably just let them go. If that person starts advancing towards that homeowner inside that home, then they can take action to take care of the problem so that homeowner isn't further victimized.
Okay. We hope that never happens.
We hope that never happens, correct.
Now, let's say that you are coming home from work. So you weren't in the home when the invasion took place, but you get there, there's a window broken, there are things missing. What do you do then?
Well, you immediately, if you notice it before you enter the house, don't go in. And you want to get on your cell phone or go to the neighbor and call 911 and let them know that you just got home and what you've seen and you think somebody could be in your house. And you'll have an officer there very quickly.
So if you went in and you noticed that things weren't right, I shouldn't be walking around trying to inspect Mm-mm. the house by myself.
No.
Someone could still be in there.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So call the police.
Step out.
Step outside, yeah. Get back in the car.
Yeah, you want to be safe until the officer can clear the house, and then you can go back in. And then you're going to have to tally up any property that might be missing, or any money or property.
Now, is that something that I report to the police or just to my insurance company?
You want to report that to the police department.
Okay.
They might get lucky and find somebody, you know, with your property. So you always want to report it.
Any other tips that we should have in terms of how to prevent a burglary or how to respond if one should happen to take place?
Well, you know, one of the smartest things that people can do is to mark their property, or at least their valuables.
Oh, okay.
You know, expensive jewelry, take pictures, keep those pictures in a safe place, you know, write down serial numbers, and mark the equipment as well. And there's a lot of different things you can do online as far as putting special stickers or dots on your equipment that make it easier to identify if and when it is recovered. And actually, we do recover quite a bit of stolen property, which only aids us in other investigations, because seldom do you have a burglar that just strikes one house.
Mm-hmm.
So when you do, you know, hit the jackpot and serve that search warrant, you're more than likely going to find stolen property from numerous thefts and burglaries.
Do you recommend safes for valuables?
Absolutely, yes.
How do you pick out a good one?
You know, there's so many different ones out there. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've got a full-size safe in my home, and then also a smaller one where we keep other valuables that we get to more often. Something that is, hard to crack, whether it be a dial type safe or one they have them, that read fingerprints, those are good. But you want to be sure that whatever safe you get isn't so light that it's easy to pick up and carry off, because that kind of defeats the purpose as well.
So are there safes that you can actually buy that anchor into the frame of your house? Aren't there?
Oh, yes, those like are that? Available. Yeah.
Okay. So if you're building a home, maybe now's the time to consider that rather than having to retrofit it at some later point.
A lot of people do that.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Simple thing, just keep your door locked and those windows locked. That's what I tell people a lot, and be aware of your surroundings.
Very good. Well, we want to thank you both for joining us on Valley Viewpoint and helping us to be a safer community. And I want to thank you for joining us for Viewpoint. If you have a desire to have more information, we have some information for you on the screen that will help you to go on to websites. It will help you to learn more. And if you have an idea or a concept for a future Viewpoint, why don't you contact us at the station? Area code 509-529-9149. Again, that's 509-529-9149, or you can simply email me at valleyviewpoint@bmt.tv. Thank you for joining us. For Viewpoint, I'm Dan Solis.